Welcome, everybody, to the Investor Shed Podcast. My name is Jeremy Kitchen, here with the lovely and beautiful Nicholas Beveridge.
Hey, how you doing today?
Doing so good. I'm doing even better now that we have a great podcast on millionaire habits.
Yeah. Hey, I kind of like this episode. What do you think?
I kind of like this episode, too. That's never how we say it. I really like this episode. No, it's been great. We go into a lot of things about how to stay, you know, tip-top shape of mind, and it's really good.
Yeah. So, Jeremy, they want to know, what are you going to eat today?
Well, what am I going to eat with my millionaire habits? Uh-huh. Honestly, I think just to keep in theme, I'm going to drink a gallon of water while I'm listening to this show.
Ooh, that's good. Mm-hmm. We almost did.
We almost did.
Drank a gallon today.
Yep, I got all my drinks right here, even though coffee does not count as water and pre-workout does not count as water. I've got my water right here as well. Drink your water, ladies and gentlemen. It is good for you and tasty if you put enough ice in it.
Enjoy this episode. You're going to love it. I guarantee it.
You're not.
Yeah, you're live or you're not. If you want to hear us live, we are on X, and we are on the Facebook page of the Investor Shed Podcast.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll try some other platforms in the future, but thanks for joining us.
Yeah,
if
absolutely.
You're watching on YouTube, it's probably a month in the future, and you know, maybe we know who's president now. I don't know.
Yeah, we know a lot of things, so just stay tuned, and we'll let you know exactly what we know. But seriously, welcome to the Investor Shed Podcast. For this first time here, Nick Beveridge and I, we are the leading source of investor entertainment in North Idaho with co-hosts named Nick and Jeremy. Really cool time to be here. Really cool time to be alive.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So enjoy. Today, we are talking about millionaire habits.
Mm-hmm.
What do you guys think about that? Are you sick of hearing that kind of stuff? I'm not.
No.
No. So I found it fascinating. So, Jeremy, at least a decade ago, I remember seeing this thing on the internet that I printed off, and it was a side-by-side comparison of millionaire habits versus poor people habits.
Okay.
And it was just a side-by-side list of like all these different things that they do.
Yeah.
And what I decided way back then was I was just going to print it off and put it up at my workspace behind my computer and just see it on my wall. And it did. It was there for like probably 9 years.
Oh, yeah.
Recently, I moved offices, so I'm in transition, so I don't get to see it every day, but it's nice to know that I think for the most part I've kind of accomplished almost everything on that list and made them habits.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, and then you got a peeky at that, didn't you?
I did. Yeah, no, that was at your office, at the KW office, for sure. It was an intriguing little poster because I remember reading it like, I wonder how real these stats are, but clearly somebody's done the math and somebody's done the actual statistics here for them to actually calculate it. So
yeah. So what we want to talk about today are just a few things that millionaires tend to do on a regular basis that poor people tend to not do.
Mm-hmm.
And we want you, if you're listening to this, you're probably on the track to being a millionaire, or you are one.
Yeah. Congratulations.
And if you are accidentally listening to this, maybe on a YouTube ad, I apologize. You can skip very soon.
I'm not gonna apologize for anything, by the way. This is our show. Welcome to it.
Yeah. So first thing we want to touch on is like developing a wealth mindset.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a habit to it. So the importance of, you know, just being in that wealth creation mindset on a regular basis. Millionaires tend to focus on opportunities, not obstacles.
Mm-hmm.
And I've noticed that to be a huge difference between quote-unquote poor people or people that are struggling, people that like to blame their situation on other people.
Mm-hmm.
They tend to almost always be focusing on the obstacles in their life and not necessarily all the opportunities that are out there.
There's a lot of truth to that, Nick.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, like, I'm not wealthy by any means, but we're doing okay. But and like you've seen a lot of transformation out of me, at least, you know, like
earlier
in my life, like definitely I was somebody who blamed the system and blamed what was happening to me versus trying to fix it.
Yeah, sure. And how did that make you feel?
Poor. Like and not just poor in like
a victim.
Wealthy. Yeah, absolutely. Like a victim, honestly.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like this is happening to me. Why is this happening to me? I didn't deserve this, you know, like. Yeah, absolutely.
And it's easy to get in that trap because that's what most people do. And most people surround themselves with people.
Mm-hmm.
And most people have this mindset that is very contagious that, you know, there's just obstacles in life everywhere. Yeah, duh.
Yeah.
Welcome to life. What I love doing is watching this show with my wife called Naked and Afraid. And it is one of those things on the side-by-side comparison that I'm probably failing at.
Sure.
Like, it's a reality TV show.
Yeah, you watch the TV that you're not really, that's not really feeding
but
you.
But I try to keep it to a minimum.
Sure.
But I love seeing people out in the wild and what they actually focus on and how easily they can get down. I mean, I guess that's a horrible thing to say, but like...
Well, yeah, but I mean, like, they're in that situation, right? And they're surrounded by just literal wilderness and problems. Like, it's hard to kind of... And that's a different show, of course. I think you're subliminally watching it because you want to be naked and afraid with your wife.
Oh, Jesus.
Like, not out there, but you just want to get naked with your wife and you're trying to, you know, implement that.
Is that... Well, I guess you got to watch the show more. It can get addicting because it's just fascinating watching people, like, with nothing try to survive for 21 days.
I've never seen
out
it.
In the wild.
Yeah.
And it's just funny the way, like, the majority of the people do struggle and they just get depressed and they're constantly just focusing on these obstacles. But every once in a while, you get these people that you can tell they come from, like, kind of a rich mindset.
Sure.
That they're probably doing better in life because they get people from all over the place.
But, of course, yeah.
Some of these people, you know, they come into the show with that positive mindset, and it really does serve them.
Oh, yeah.
Because all they're focused on are all the opportunities that are out there,
right?
Even though they have nothing.
Yeah.
But there's so, like, the land can provide.
Sure.
And in America, holy crap, there's a lot of opportunity out there.
Absolutely.
And it is so easy to get stuck in all the obstacles. But you know, if the one thing that my the biggest thing that millionaires on a regular basis do is that they just focus on opportunities. They spend the they live in opportunity land.
Right. I love that.
Yeah,
that's a really good analogy for that. And you know, like what Nick said, like building your wealth mindset, it's really going to be your foundation for anything you do going forward. Because you know, having a wealth mindset, again, when we talk about wealth here, we're not just talking about financial wealth. We're talking about an abundance of resources, an abundance of life. And it doesn't have to all be financially related, but, you know, like it can be health, it can be mindset, it can be a lot of things. But having a mindset stating that, you know, like there are opportunities out there is going to serve you very well.
Yeah. And I think what really helps them get through that and stay in that mindset is the acceptance of obstacles.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's just... That's just life. And I think that they have a better, they've done a better job of accepting that there are going to be obstacles and challenges with everything. And you can either focus on that or continue to focus on the opportunities as you plow through these challenges.
Sure.
And the challenges you've accepted in advance, and that way they're easier to deal with, you know?
Yeah.
And it's part of like when back of another episode that we talked about, like the baby dragons episode, I think a lot of it has to do with that. When challenges do arise, they tend to stomp on them immediately instead of waiting for them to grow into bigger issues.
Yeah. And that's really real.
And I've noticed that with, you know, the poor people, they tend to not stomp on problems right away.
Right.
They let them build.
Yeah.
And that's what does kind of cripple them in a way.
It's like a fire's easy to douse when it just gets started, right? Like you have a little tiny kitchen fire, it's in your frying pan, right? You can take care of that. But if you just leave it, it will burn your whole kitchen down, which will burn your whole house down, which will burn your whole neighborhood down. Like the problems will get exponentially bigger if you don't take care of them. And it's a hard trap to get out of, I will say. Like, I mean, like I've been in both mindsets, of course. Like, do you have any advice for anybody who's, I guess, stuck in that mindset of, you know, these problems are taking control of me and what to do about it?
Yeah. So I think the first thing I would do if it were me is just come to Jesus moment with reality that life is going to be full of problems. They're not going away. There's just going to be more.
Yep.
And just make that part of your plan to deal with problems on a regular basis.
Yeah.
And maybe you devote a certain amount of time every morning to just crush a few of them before you go on with your day.
Yeah.
And that could be, you know, some of these challenges could be your body, you know, just trying to stay in shape every day is hard for most people.
Yeah.
Trying to set your kitchen up right to where you're eating, well throughout the day, staying hydrated.
Yeah.
All these weird little tiny things, but they do stack up.
They absolutely do.
But you got to try to be prepared for the day and tomorrow.
Yeah.
Don't always just like live on a whim. And that's what most, you know.
Yeah.
Poor people do. They wake up late and they're running and they're chasing the day versus, well, not chasing the day. They're being chased by the day.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Say the wealthy versus the wealthy tend to chase the day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Do you want to be you want to be the lion and chase the prey, or do you want to be the prey and that you're constantly running from the lion and that's your day?
And I think, you know, the way I guess society is almost set up is that, like, there needs to be a divide with that kind of stuff. I'm not saying I approve of it, but, like, most people are going to be in a poor mindset. Most people are. Because one, they either A, don't know any better, B, don't care, or C, don't have the tools to get out of it.
Mm-hmm. When it comes to real estate, if you want to stay in an abundance mindset, walk out the front door, look around, and just realize, oh, there's a bunch of real estate out here.
Yeah.
Maybe not all of it's on the market.
Right.
But there's a lot of opportunity out there. You drive around and you can't get away from real estate. It's everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It's under your feet at all times. There's opportunity everywhere and there's people everywhere. To be successful in real estate, you've just got to be a little savvy when it comes to real estate, which is everywhere, and people that are everywhere.
Yeah.
And know that there's an abundance of people. There's an abundance of real estate. So that means that there is an abundance of opportunity, but sometimes you have to create it or find it.
Yeah. And I think one of the most important things about having a millionaire mindset, and I learned this pretty early on too, like it's the problem solving trait of, you know, getting stuck in the I can't do that versus how can I make that happen.
Yeah. Yeah, you got to switch some of the language in your head and make a habit of that. Mm-hmm. Like, make a habit of switching up exactly what you said.
Yeah.
I can't do that. You should just eliminate it from your vocabulary if you can.
Yeah, need to stop your word in there for sure.
Yeah. Stop saying things like I can't, or stop blaming people and start trying to take personal responsibility for your life, and you'll feel this immense weight lifted off your shoulder.
Yeah.
Not the opposite, which some people think. When they take responsibility, they think they put a bunch of weight on their shoulders, but they haven't.
Yeah. And we'll talk about this a little bit later. It kind of rolls into this, but instead of saying, you know, I can't, like I can't and how can I are definitely two things you should switch. But another thing we are going to talk about later is saying no intentionally.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll definitely get to that.
Yeah.
So some actionable tips, if you want to work on developing your wealth mindset and be in an abundance opportunity, type of, you know, vibe at all times, Arnold Schwarzenegger had one of the best tips ever. It was that he visualizes his life in the future. That simple, but most people don't do it.
Right.
Like, what do you visualize and visualize on a regular basis? Or you could do the affirmation things. I think it's a bunch of bullshit, but that's what a lot of people recommend. I just think it's corny, too corny. I don't want to stare in the mirror and be like, you are a bitch person and you are beautiful. And I'm just going to break the mirror if I start talking like that. but I can visualize all day long.
Yeah.
And what happens when you are regularly visualizing what you want your life to look like, naturally, you're just going to walk in that direction with your actions throughout your day to get there.
Yeah. And another way to say that is, you know, what you focus on expands. I'm sure you've probably heard that as well. But, you know, what you said, visualize your day and visualize how you want it to go and just, like, act that part. Like, be the person who does these things. Like, a person who is fit, what do they do every day? They make changes in their life and choices in their life that make them fit. So they wake up early. They work out. They eat right. They drink a bunch of water. They do these things. So, like, the little steps get you the result, basically.
Yeah. Here's something, another habit that the millionaires do. They have a habit of making time management and their schedule very inflexible. They micromanage the hell out of their own personal time.
Mm-hmm.
So what I mean by that is, like, they try to be as efficient as possible. They like to work, like, most of them, obviously, they own a business.
Yeah.
They try to work on their business, not in their business, as much as possible. And they do, like you said, that they have the power of saying no to anything that impedes them from that vision that they're working towards.
Mm-hmm.
So they tend to say no a lot to opportunities that distract them from what their main goal is.
Mm-hmm.
And they do follow a calendar. Like, for instance, what I've gotten in the habit of doing over the last decade or so, in my real estate business is I follow a calendar religiously.
Yeah.
I have Google Calendar, downloaded on my phone. It's on all my computers.
Probably streams to your watch and everything,
yep,
too.
Yep, it's on my watch. I get, when it's time to do something else, I get buzzed. Mm-hmm. And I follow my calendar because those habits I can set in my calendar.
Yeah.
So I don't have to think about it. I just do it. If you can, you know, set the right calendar, you can set the right life up for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a habit of, you know, when I wake up, right now I'm doing the 75 hard again, so I'm reading.
Mm-hmm.
10 pages a day in the morning. I do a 45 minute workout either at the gym or at home. Mm-hmm. Or I'll go on a walk outside. And then, you know, when I get ready for the day, I'm usually, you know, that's about 3 hours before I have to go to work.
Sure.
When I get ready for the day, I look at my calendar again and I see, do I have any afternoon appointments that I should be wearing maybe more than a black t-shirt for?
Right.
You know, am I meeting with any new sellers today?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what's funny nowadays, even if I am meeting with a brand new seller, I'll probably still just wear a black t-shirt,
yeah,
but maybe I'll wear nicer shoes.
Right.
And my shoes aren't that nice, but.
And that's okay. So speaking on that level, like, I think that's very important right now. So we're talking about millionaire habits right now. Nick does not dress like a millionaire.
No.
And here's the point with that. Like, because he's not letting his toys control him, right? Like, he doesn't need a $50,000 suit. He doesn't need a $400 haircut. He doesn't need, you know, a pair of shoes that cost him $1,000 that are made out of alligator leather.
No, I get whatever's on sale,
right,
on Amazon, typically.
And I like, as somebody, like, I mean, like, I'm pretty, we're pretty casually close to what we, yeah, look like. I love it. Like, I don't compare myself to how other people look in their clothes because I don't care. And that's something you should really get in the habit of doing. You know, dressing comfortable, but for the job and for the role you're looking to be, for sure. But it doesn't need to be incredibly expensive, and you don't need to waste money on clothing and vanity items, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah. And I do it more just because I'm in the habit of wearing the same clothes every day, so I don't have to think about it. It's
right.
More, it just frees up my mind,
right,
to think about other things.
Because mm-hmm.
I do believe that if you're constantly trying to pick out what you're going to wear that day, it you know, you only have so many decisions that you can make in a day before you get burnt out.
We've got like a limited number of bandwidth that you can basically make decisions,
yeah,
for.
So I'll buy in bulk a bunch of black t-shirts, yep, and I'll have almost the same jeans during the summer. I have many pairs of shorts, but I usually wear the same pair of shorts,
yeah,
for the 4 days in a row until they start to stink. So yeah, I guess I don't have the best, like, I don't have the best advice for casual wear.
Yeah, we're not fashion aficionados, is what we're saying.
But I do have all that time freed up in my head, mm-hmm, to just wear the same thing.
Yeah.
Every day, it's not a big deal. People have gotten used to it. They don't care.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. Most people don't care what you wear. Most people care what they wear.
Exactly. Yeah.
And if you can get out of that habit of constantly caring about that, it does free up. I believe it just frees up your mind to focus on other things.
I agree with you.
And I kind of stole that from Gary Keller.
Yeah.
Gary Keller would always wear a long sleeve black t-shirt.
Okay.
And I thought that was cool. Like, this, he's probably a billionaire.
Right.
This guy is just, you know, he's wearing jeans and a long sleeve black t-shirt all the time.
Yeah.
Which is weird. He lives in Texas. I don't know why he wouldn't just wear a t-shirt. Maybe he has weird flabby arms.
Maybe your killer has weird flabby arms, for sure. But I mean, just like, look at the people who, you know, are millionaires. Look at the Brandon Turners. Look at all these people who are doing this on a high level. Look at how they dress. Like,
yeah,
they're pretty casual.
Mm-hmm.
And again, this is just something that we're talking about. It's very minimal bandwidth, but it definitely does take some. And it is nice, like you said, like, I wear black shirts just because I'm a pretty sweaty dude. This yeah, covers the pits up pretty well, to be honest with you.
So you're planning in advance.
I'm planning in advance. It's called, mm-hmm, function and fashion. So, you know, my wardrobe's a lot like yours, like black t-shirts and shorts and pants. And it's so automatic when I wake up in the morning. I'm just like, I don't even have to wonder. I just, like,
yeah,
pull a black shirt off the shelf and I'm like, I'm going.
Yeah. So anyway, we got derailed a little bit from the calendar.
Sure.
But, like, for instance, what, and I didn't create this on my own. I modeled other people, mm-hmm, other millionaires, what they typically do, like, in the real estate industry with their calendars. And I do my deep work in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to actively create business.
Yeah.
Like right now, we're recording a podcast. This is part of lead generation.
Yep.
I spend most of, you know, the first half of my day till about noon, setting appointments or doing some sort of lead generation activity, and I'm working on growing my business.
Awesome.
And then the second half of the day, I leave up for appointments, and that's more servicing the business. That's, mm-hmm. You know, so appointments with investors, or vendors or whoever, mm-hmm. I try to leave for the afternoons. That way I don't, let my, you know, other people or my business try to control me. I've controlled, okay, growing the business in the morning,
yeah,
servicing in the afternoon.
Sure.
And, I am not, I do not currently run a business that runs itself. I did for a little bit. Mm-hmm. We downscaled. But for the most part, I would say it's like 80% of it is kind of run on its own, but it still needs my 20% activities.
You've got certain systems and people in place that will, you know, take most of the load off your plate, but still like you got to keep an eye on these things every now and then.
So I'm not totally in the B quadrant. Mm-hmm. If you're a follower of Rich Dad Poor Dad, I'm still in the S. But there are other things that I've put in place that kind of bring me to that I category, with my investments and stuff. So I'm working on getting there. Yeah. I'm just not sure if the real estate agent business is something that can actually get to the B quadrant.
Right.
And that's why I'm working on something else in the background that potentially can. Anyway.
Yeah.
So that's the calendar. Rich people, mm-hmm. millionaires, they tend to be, they have a habit of being very tedious with their time.
Yeah. And I think I've said this example before, but if you've ever heard Grant Cardone, the guy is a maniac with his calendar and his Salesforce team. He'll go into examples. He's like, when I was young and hustling, like I would schedule out my entire day by the minute. Like he's typing out in his calendar, like take a piss from 11:17 to 11:20. Like, and then 11:21 back to making phone calls, and that kind of work and that kind of habit is it's exponential growth, because, you know, a lot of people, they don't do that. You know, we dick around for a few minutes in the morning, and you dick around for a few minutes here, and you take a longer lunch. Suddenly you've lost 3 hours in your day.
Yeah. And potentially the reason why he's doing that is so that he's getting dopamine hits throughout the day. Like he's got this, you know, this checklist of things that he needs to do or calendar, and he's knocking them off one by one. And you know, if you're working in a factory and you're cranking out widgets every day, it is satisfying. And when you're in the service business, you know, it can be rough sometimes, because you don't really, you know, the business never stops sometimes.
It's true.
Like, you can go months on working on a transaction and it can go nowhere or eventually close, but it's like, it can take a while before you actually feel that satisfaction of I've completed something.
Yeah.
And if you want to start feeling like you've completed stuff, just write out a list of everything that you got to do that day and just start checking it off. And you'll get, if you can get in the habit of that, just checking off stuff on your list, boy, will it feel good by the evening. Like you've actually had a productive day.
Yeah. So every single day, I wake up. The first thing I do is I wake up and I set my to-do list. It's not on my calendar, because my calendar kind of varies. I am in the service business. It's very client-based, you know?
Yeah.
But the first thing I do is I wake up and I'm like, okay, what do I need to hit first? How long do I need to hit it? Here's what I need to do. And here's my big main objectives for the day. And then throughout the day, I'll constantly add just a little few ones down the bottom. Checking them off and getting those dopamine hits really, really is pretty great.
Yeah. Yeah. So you've experienced that.
Yeah.
You know what it's like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So we talked about that. The third big habit, continuous learning.
Yeah.
Millionaires actually have a habit of, on a regular basis, they are investing in their own self-education. Mm-hmm. May sound corny, but that's what they do.
Yep.
Whether it's through books, podcasts, seminars, mentors, consistent learning is crucial. They, on a regular basis are, attending networking events.
Yeah.
Or, seminars, or they have, you know, they're reading actual books in self-development. Like they're constantly growing their mind. They have a habit of it. And if you are, if you don't have this habit currently, and if you're not wealthy, maybe try it out.
Yeah.
Yeah. What do you think?
No, I think that's great. Lifelong learners, like there's really not a day that goes by where I don't try to learn something new.
Yeah. And prior to your wealth journey a few years ago, how often were you in, like, doing anything like this? Were you ever reading anything?
No. Never.
Because I remember you read books, but was it all entertainment?
Yeah, it was all entertainment. It was sci-fi, horror, you know, fantasy books, which there's nothing really inherently wrong with that, but it wasn't like, it wasn't growing my brain, and it wasn't like getting me to think differently about problems and solutions. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, honestly, we go to networking events, podcasts, audiobooks, books, meetings with clients. Just get yourself in a healthy mindset of being an always learner. And if somebody's doing something really cool, just ask them how they're doing it.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people, like, they love talking about their business and they love talking about their success. If you're interested in something they're doing, like, just ask them to coffee. And most people will be honored that you're honestly asking them to coffee. And, yeah, and they'd be willing to share almost anything you want.
Yeah. And, you know, attend our networking event. We have a networking event for newer investors, regular, or seasoned investors, whoever, just investors that want to come and just network, grow their business, or just get started. We do it the first Thursday of each month at 6:30 at our new office, Government Way.
Nice.
We just purchased probably by the time this comes out, I think we'll have closed.
Yeah. So you haven't closed yet and you're already there?
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. So we had our first meeting last night. It was part of our agreement in our contract was that we get to use it for the, you know, twice before we start. But, you know, it's a big commercial property, so it takes some time to close. And we would actually close earlier, but they have a tenant in the front office that needs it until like October 15th or something.
Cool.
So that's why and we also, I mean, we had this networking, we have this seminar that we're putting on in Coeur d'Alene. When this comes out, I think it's already, going to be done, but we might do it again. But, we have a 2-day event, and it's a great place to meet people and just get involved in the community. If you've already missed that and you wonder what should you do? If you're not doing any of this, just read Rich Dad Poor Dad.
Yeah, start with something.
That's a great book to start with.
Yeah.
Rich Dad Poor Dad, I think, is like the if you haven't read any self-development books, that's probably the best book to start with.
Yeah, I think it would depend on your scenario and like what you're actually looking for, but it is a building block and it is a crucial read for investors for sure.
Yeah, and then pretty much anything by Napoleon Hill, I really love. So what any recommendations on books?
Tons, honestly, but it just depends on, again, what you're looking for. If you're looking for investment material, like Nick said, Rich Dad Poor Dad's great. Brandon Turner and Josh, I forgot his name, Josh at the Bigger Pockets. There's the How to Invest in Real Estate book.
Yeah.
That one's very good too.
Josh Dorkin.
Yeah. Excuse me. He hasn't been on Bigger Pockets in like...
He's old.
Yeah. No.
Yeah.
But they wrote a book together. It was like How to Invest in Real Estate and for Dummies or something like that. And it's very easy if you're trying to get started on it. If you're looking for habit books, Atomic Habits is always a great one by James Clear. High Five Habit by Mel Robbins. That one's very good.
I don't think it's called Invest for Dummies.
It's not for Dummies. It's How to Invest in Real Estate, I think, is what it's called.
Yeah.
But it gives you basically...
They have so many books.
They do. But it was the first one they wrote together.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
And it gives you like 21 ways to make real estate without money or buy real estate without money or something like that. It was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Again, we've got a lot of books. I'm constantly reading. I'm constantly listening to podcasts.
Yeah.
Podcasts I'd recommend definitely ours because, you know, we're pretty much the coolest.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And then I like Main Street Business Podcasts with Matt Sorensen and Mark Kohler for sure.
Mm-hmm. Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill is probably like the best book outside of Rich Dad Poor Dad I've read. Mm-hmm. And that one I've reread several times. All right. So building multiple streams of income is another habit that millionaires tend to have.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, ask yourself, how many streams of income do you have? Do you have just a job and that's it? That's your one stream. What if it dries up? You know, you got to be thinking about this, you know, money is water kind of thing. And and if you want plenty of water, you need plenty of streams.
Yeah. And they can be small streams to start too, by the way. Like,
yeah, of course.
It doesn't, not every stream needs to like hold over your W-2 job or anything like that. But the streams need to definitely be started so they can compound and grow.
Yeah. And it's also just a safety measure.
Yep.
You know, this is definitely more of a defense tactic, I believe. Millionaires just don't want to rely on just one source of income. They want to diversify.
Yeah.
Not because they're scatterbrained.
Right.
But just because it's a safe play because, I mean, over time, doing one thing to get one source of income can dry up or change.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you know, if you have multiple streams, you know, ideally five to seven or so different streams of income. Like for instance, I make real estate commission income. Mm-hmm. I make a profit share. Mm-hmm. I also make money on stock investing that mm-hmm. I do. I make money for my rental properties as a form of passive income. Mm-hmm. I have an RV park that I make money from. Separate source there.
Yeah.
We flip houses. You and I are flipping one house right now together that took us, let's see, how many hours do you think we spent on this property?
Hours did I spend? I spent two.
You spent 2 hours? Yeah. I probably spent, with drive time and stuff, maybe 6 hours.
Yeah.
We're making 38 grand on that property together. Yeah. but that's, you know, it's another source.
Yeah.
It's not a reliable source, but we know how to flip houses.
Right.
And in that one, we did a wholetail. We'll talk about that one later.
I love it. Like, I mean, and we'll talk about that here just while we're here, but like, we just both use credit lines, and like, I was factoring in, if we close within the next month, I'm only going to be paying like $400 out of my pocket for this house.
Uh-huh.
And if I'm making 18,000, that's it was like a 2,400% return.
Yep. Yeah. Not bad.
Yeah. Not too shabby.
Yeah. Another source of income is our hard money lending business. Yep. It's not a huge part of our portfolio, but mm-hmm. it's another source. Mm-hmm. And what we're doing is like, we're building these skills. Like, we know how to make money in other arenas. So if one thing shuts down, we're okay. Mm-hmm. You know, if our hard money business went away, we're not like going to lose our homes.
Right.
if my real estate commissions went away, that would suck. But I've got all these other things that I can work on.
Right.
That are already bringing in money, and I can just ramp up the effort on something else.
That's definitely goes into, you know, millionaire habits too. If you're trying to become a millionaire, like, and Nick talks about this with the flow of money, like, go where the money is. Like, it's so easy to make money.
It can. Yes, if you have the right mindset about
it. Right, and that's what I'm saying. I guess if you know, like, okay, what's something people need? How can I do this? And you start asking yourself, how can I, instead of I can't make money?
Yep.
You will absolutely find a way to make money.
it's simple. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't necessarily say it's easy.
I agree with you. Okay.
But making money can be very simple.
Yeah.
Anyway, and that's a vague statement.
Right.
Anyway, leveraging relationships is another habit that millionaires tend to be in. Mm-hmm. And this goes with networking. So millionaires know the value of who they know, not just what they know.
Sure.
Because they know that if they know the right who, that person knows the right what.
Right.
So it's all about who.
Yeah.
They ask themselves who, not why. And the difference between millionaires and poor people, mm-hmm. for instance, is poor people tend to ask themselves why whenever they have an issue, whenever they have an obstacle. Why is this happening?
Right.
What is it? Like, why? They ask why. Millionaires, whenever they have a challenge, most of the time it's who.
Yeah.
Who can solve this for me?
Yep.
And they ask who, not why. They don't want to dwell. You know, they're always looking forward. That's mm-hmm. right. Your windshield is bigger than your little mirror to look in your back window.
Yeah. And I think Dan Sullivan has a book. It's Who Not How.
Hey, quick commercial break here. Thank you so much for listening to this podcast. I really do appreciate it. If you want to give back, let me help you buy a house, or I can help you sell a house. It's the only way I make money when I'm not investing in real estate. I don't make money on this podcast or the events I do. But I do make money only when I help people buy and sell houses. So if you're looking for your next investment and you're here in North Idaho, I want to help you personally. If you are not in North Idaho, I can still help you out. I have a vast network of referral partners all across the country, and I can find the right real estate investor savvy agent for you so you don't have to. It doesn't cost you a thing. Thank you for your support. Back to the show. Who not how?
Yeah, same thing though. Same concept. Like,
it's a whole book on something very simple.
Yeah, very simple concept, but a very good book at the same time. So,
yeah, So they know the importance, and they make it a habit of building and maintaining relationships with, you know, in the real estate community, for instance, you mm-hmm. know, and we have these networking events. I know we just talked about this earlier, but mm-hmm. I've noticed that the more wealthy people, mm-hmm. Tend to show up regularly to these networking events, even though you think they wouldn't have to. Like, they're already doing well, but they do it anyway.
Yeah,
they're constantly growing their network, and it's not just about growing your network. It's also about following up and maintaining relationships.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you can definitely, you can spend a week growing a huge network, and then if you don't maintain it, it doesn't mean anything. People aren't going to remember you.
Right.
I don't know. Does that make sense, Jeremy?
Yeah, no, that absolutely makes sense. And if you're not going to take action on it, like, yeah, it's not going to really be effective to you.
Yep. So other than just networking events, there's, you know, these industry events that are out there. Mm-hmm. So if you're really into like alternative investments, for instance, Matt Swartzen has a big, event coming up for alternative investments.
Yeah.
I forgot when it is.
October something.
Yeah. Or like whatever industry you're in, I'm sure like if you're in the HVAC business, there are probably HVAC conventions out there.
Yeah.
Maybe go be a part of them and meet with the big players. Mm-hmm. A lot of them get into mentorships, you know, either structured or unstructured mentorships. And a lot of them join mastermind groups.
Yeah.
Napoleon Hill was huge on the mastermind idea. But that's, you know, a group of people that are all kind of in the same industry that meet regularly, you know, once a quarter or so.
Yeah.
And they just talk about what they're doing in their businesses, what kind of challenges they're having, what they're having success with.
Mm-hmm.
And it, typically in these big masterminds group, it's mastermind. How did we all do better? How can we all work together in the same industry to serve our clients better, make more money?
Yeah. Very good point. And like with the networking and leveraging, like the way business works is it's not about you. It's about the relationship for the most part. You know, you need to really leverage your network and utilize other people because nobody does this alone.
Yep.
Nobody does it alone.
No.
And if you are doing it alone, you are going to burn out so damn fast.
And I mean, I totally know the power of this because we started a networking event.
Yeah.
and I knew how powerful it was before I started a networking event because that was where I learned the most. Mm-hmm. Like just getting to meet other people that are like-minded, trying to do the same thing.
Yeah.
And try to be surrounded by those kind of people on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, we have a monthly meeting, but sometimes it's not enough for me. I like to go to other people's networking events.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that. I like to try to make it a habit. It's on the calendar. Just go.
Mm-hmm.
Good things almost always come of it.
Yeah.
You know, there's always some business that comes from it and some new relationship I may make.
Absolutely. And to kind of go on this, what's the saying? It's like you are the sum of the five people you hang around with. There's a lot of power in that statement as well. Like if you have friends who are Debbie Downers or who have really bad habits, you are more apt to take on those bad habits from them.
True. Yeah. Yeah. You are the five people you surround yourself with.
So if you find yourself struggling and like in a rut of, you know, why can't I get any traction or why can't I make money or why can't I do this? Maybe you should take a look at your friend group.
Yeah. And blame them.
And
no, I'm kidding.
And
no,
shame and blame.
No, you blame yourself. You know, take responsibility for where you are in life and where you've put yourself, and don't tell yourself that somebody else put you there. Give yourself the control back, and that the only way you can do that is by taking personal accountability, personal responsibility for your life and for your actions.
Mm-hmm.
Can you make a very good claim for blaming people for things that happen to you? Of course,
absolutely.
But
I've been there.
It's not going to do you any good.
No.
The only thing that's going to do you actually good is by taking, you can almost always in any situation take blame for something.
Mm-hmm.
And at the least, it's just because you were there.
Right.
So, take responsibility. And that will give, and the biggest thing is like in your mind, it will give you that power to move forward.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to sit there and dwell and wait for somebody else to fix something for you.
Yeah. I think, and this isn't really in any of our show notes or anything, but I think something that's really important for habits, it's a two-step kind of program. It's persistence and consistency. So really what I mean by that is like, keep going. And Alex Hormozzi said this too, you know, like do something so long that it's impossible for you to be bad at it.
Yeah. Practice so much.
Yeah. Practice mm-hmm. so much. Just do it until you're not bad at it anymore. Consistency, because what's going to happen is if you're not consistent, like imagine this like a baseball swing, right? You swing the baseball, you hit it, and the ball just flies out. You need to really follow through hitting that baseball so you can knock it out of the park. You have to really stay consistent in your business and in your health and in your mindset and your goals, because if you fall off, it's okay to fall off, but if you fall off, you just start losing a ton of trajectory.
Yeah, totally. And that's a good transition to the next habit. Millionaires tend to have a habit of a health routine and personal disciplines in their overall well-being. It sounds like, oh yeah, duh, but it's true. Mm-hmm. Like, look at your average poor person and look at their body.
Yeah.
And then look at the average millionaire and look at their body.
Mm-hmm.
Not always, but most of the time you will see a difference. You will see someone who takes care of themselves versus someone who just, it's not a priority.
Right.
You know? And I remember this coach that was in our office.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was a coach for newer agents. But he was not physically in good shape at all. And I think most people had there was a struggle kind of getting people to be motivated by this coach. And I think a lot of it had to do, if I don't mean to be mean, but this guy was seriously overweight.
Mm-hmm.
And how could you try to take or motivation from somebody who can't even take care of themselves?
Right.
That's true.
Yeah.
It didn't work out with that guy. I heard he was a really good coach. He knew his real estate.
Mm-hmm.
But just his presence, put everybody, who had a half a brain cell at a little skepticism, like, wait, you want to ingrain routines into me and you can't do it for yourself.
Yeah.
good routines. Millionaires have a habit of taking care of their body.
Yeah.
And you can overcomplicate this or you can try to keep it simple. I love living in today's world where everybody can affordably have a little watch that tells them how many steps they're in every day. I love that the culture in general is really they're trying to limit how much they drink alcohol.
Yeah, I love
it. In general, it seems like that. In general, or maybe it's just our group. I don't know if it's like this around the country.
I don't think it's everybody. I think it is we are seeing the people who are trying to make change.
Yeah. I've definitely just noticed a shift in most people that we surround ourselves with, that most people are very health conscious and they're trying to make it a habit of eating well and limiting their alcohol. It's not something I still like a drink here and there. So do most people. But it's interesting being in my young 20s and our friend group where that was just never a priority. No. nobody got up early to work out.
It was never a priority to be sober in our 20s.
Yeah. But neither was our friend group either.
Exactly.
Nobody in the house was getting up and going on a run, or regularly hydrating.
Yeah.
That wasn't Blue Moon. sounds simple enough, but look at your average poor person.
Mm-hmm.
They're fat, they consume too much sugar.
Right. And like I said earlier, become the person who does these things. Right. So ask yourself, is this habit something that a wealthy person with a wealthy mindset would do? Is buying 20 beers and drinking them tonight, is that something that's going to push me to my goal?
Yeah.
If your goal is to drink 20 beers a night, yes, absolutely, it will push you there. But if your goal is to be healthy and have abundance mindset and, get out of ruts and get out of mental fogs, maybe not. Maybe not.
Yeah. So I'm going to make a recommendation to anyone out there who is struggling with their health, who is struggling trying to just, stay in shape or try to exercise regularly. Start with the real basics and just try to make a goal to just do one thing at a time. Don't run to the gym.
Yep.
And change your food habits. Don't try to change it all at once, because what's likely going to happen is that it's going to hurt. And it's going to hurt so bad. And it's going to feel so strange that you'll go right back to your old habits. Slowly ease into it.
I love that.
And what you can start with simply is by drinking more water throughout the day.
Yeah.
And keeping track of, am I drinking a gallon of water a day?
Mm-hmm.
And what will happen if you're drinking, I would recommend a gallon a day.
Mm-hmm.
of pure water. Don't add anything to it.
Yeah, this stuff we just drank was not water.
If you
this
add stuff, you know, pre-workout or whatever, then, you know, just consider that that doesn't count. I still need a gallon of
coffee
water.
Coffee doesn't count.
Coffee doesn't count. That'll actually take away fluids from your body. But there's these things out there. Not everybody knows that. But if you do drink just a gallon of pure water a day, naturally, you won't eat as much.
Mm-hmm.
It's magical what will happen to your body if you're just hydrated.
Yeah.
And your mind will be more clear because you're hydrated.
Yeah.
I've known people that, like, they weren't idiots or anything like that, but they just, like, drinking water is just not a habit of theirs.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe it, like, being with somebody for a full day, and I'm like, haven't seen you drink an ounce of water.
Yeah.
Like, how is your mouth moving?
Right. How are you not a dried up sponge?
Yeah,
right
how
now?
Are you not dried up? But I did notice that, like, when I spent a day with somebody, I was mentoring for a day, but I just noticed they weren't drinking anything. But mm-hmm. he had such low energy.
Yeah,
such low energy, and I figured it out. I'm like, this guy's not hydrated.
He probably needs some water.
Sounds stupid.
Yeah.
But, like, start with that. Mm-hmm. Because if you are drinking a full gallon of water a day, you're going to pee more. But you will eat less,
yeah,
too. And you'll probably have more energy. Just start with that.
Yeah.
And then you can start working in the exercises and try to get 10,000 steps a day.
Right.
Maybe you can add that, too. Can you get up to 10,000 steps a day and drink a gallon of water? Because if you can do that, you're light years ahead of most people.
Right.
And but do it consistently. Do mm-hmm. it every day. And you will notice a difference. You know, take a picture today and then take a picture next week and take another picture the following week. Take a picture every week.
Yeah.
And just notice the difference in your body and how mm-hmm. it's changing. If you could just stick with those things and then go hire a personal trainer.
Yeah. And I love that, honestly, Nick. So, like, what you said, like, I mean, like, I think it depends on, you know, the person's body and the person's type and everything,
yeah,
like that, of course. So, like, if you're really serious about this, I would consult a doctor. But, you know, what Nick's saying about starting with a very small habit is so crucial. Because what you don't want to do is you don't want to go buy a gym membership. You don't want to go buy gym shorts, do all these things, hire a personal trainer, and then get overwhelmed, like, oh, crap.
Yeah. Yeah, if it's not a part of your lifestyle at all, you will get overwhelmed
huge
very
changes
quickly.
Like that. Like, it doesn't matter what industry it is. Like, huge changes have huge repercussions. So if you start very small on an atomic level, again, Atomic Habits is a very good book for this particular thing.
Uh-huh.
What he talks about, have you read Atomic Habits?
I did.
Okay. Yeah. So what he talks about a few things. So, you know, you do a task and you receive a dopamine hit for completing the task. And he calls it habit stacking. So what he does, he's like, instead of like, okay, I went and worked out for 5 minutes, my dopamine hit that I want is a Twinkie. What he wants is, he's like, okay, so you can actually trick your brain into thinking, okay, so I did my 10-minute workout. I'm going to reward myself with a dopamine hit of drinking more water.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So yeah, it doesn't need to be like, you know, like a sugar workout. You can actually trick your brain into thinking that, okay, I did a good thing for myself. Now I'm going to reward myself with another good thing.
Yeah.
So you basically take this little thing. If your goal was 5,000 steps, whatever your goal is, right? So you hit your 5,000 steps. All right. My reward is I get to do another 1,000.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So, like, I treated my body so well, I'm going to say thank you even more to my body by mm-hmm. saying, hey, my reward for getting to 5 is getting to 6.
I'm going to have and some sore calves.
You start. That's the sore calves, right? But you stack these. Basically, you implement the reward into a new habit that you stack. And then you just slowly start rewarding yourself with another new habit.
Yeah. So, yeah, if you're, again, if you're not used to exercising,
right,
if you're not used to hydrating, take it easy at first.
Step
into this, but you got to make it consistent or it's mm-hmm. not going to work.
Mm-hmm.
If you are already kind of have decent habits, step it up.
Yeah.
You know, step up your game if you can. And you know what I mean by that.
and this is important too. So if you are going to be making any changes in your life, they need to be, like, what's the goals? It's SMART. So they need to be
sustainable,
measurable.
I'm making it up.
It's measurable.
Actionable.
Actionable.
Realistic.
Realistic. and timed.
Timed, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't. We have to double check what the S is, but you follow those basically, and you track everything because you have no idea if you're actually making any progress if you're not tracking it.
Yeah. Yep. And that's why, like, yeah, it's pretty easy to track a gallon of water a day.
Right.
Just like get yourself something. Like I carry around a blue bottle mm-hmm. that I know if I fill this up five times mm-hmm. and drink five of these, that's a gallon.
Yeah.
Keep it simple. Or you can walk around with a gallon like some idiots. No, I'm just kidding.
Mine's I'm just 40, kidding.
That
mine's,
was me.
Mine's 40 ounces. So, you know, three and a little bit of change is my gallon.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Let's talk about, we'll wrap this up after we talk about some fun stats.
Okay.
So cool. We're going to compare millionaires, rich people versus poor people.
Mm-hmm.
And these are interesting, very interesting stats. Some of them may be duh, but, it's interesting. I'm curious how they measure this, but when it comes to TV consumption, millionaires, they tend to spend 1 hour or less a day watching TV.
Mm-hmm.
Poor people, 5 hours or more a day. 77% of
holy moly,
77% of poor people, 5 hours or more of TV a day,
and the other 23% can't afford a TV.
5 hours a day, Jeremy. Yeah,
that's wild.
That's 150 hours a month.
That's a lot of TV.
150 hours a month. That you do you know what you can do with 150 hours a month?
A lot.
You can be a pilot.
Yeah.
I think month one.
Done.
Yeah. Anyway, reading habits. Millionaires, 88% of them mm-hmm. read at least 30 minutes a day.
Mm-hmm.
Specifically self-improvement or business-based books.
Yeah.
When it comes to reading self-improvement or self-improvement books, poor people spend about 2% of poor people actually read anything to do with self-improvement.
Okay.
So out of 100 people, mm-hmm. two of them are like, yeah, I read self-improvement stuff.
Sure.
Like that's very low number.
Right.
Compared to rich people, 88 out of 100.
Yeah. 88%, yeah. It's wild. And it just shows you like these little habits, they have major implications, right? So you can set this stuff up and it just gets you in the best mindset to make the best decisions for you.
So if you are out there and you are poor, but you're reading the self-improvements, you're the 2%, which means that you're on your way
right.
to becoming the 88%.
Mm-hmm.
So just keep reading.
Yeah, keep reading. Keep your consistency up.
Exercise. All right. 76% of millionaires aerobically exercise about 4 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
Poor people, on average, 23% exercise regularly.
Yeah.
So that means that, over 70% do not exercise at all.
Wild.
Yeah. That's a huge number.
Yeah.
Networking and building relationships, 79% of millionaires network and engage in professional or group settings.
Mm-hmm.
Poor people, rarely or never.
Yeah, okay. Well, why would they? I mean, like, there's no reason for them to if they...
This is interesting. It's this is on a different type of TV.
Mm-hmm.
Time spent on reality TV shows. So 6% of millionaires actually watch reality TV. 78% of poor people watch reality TV regularly.
That's wild. And like this is like these stats, and which is very curious to know, like where people. I think cell phones have taken a different, like social media,
yeah,
specifically has taken a whole bunch of different things as well. You're one of the anomalies who watches reality TV as a quote unquote millionaire, huh?
Yeah, I like two shows. I like the survival shows,
mm-hmm.
like Naked and Afraid, Alone. I like those shows.
Yeah.
Because I get to learn, like if I ever, and this is my thing. Like someday if we ever get nuked, I want to know how to survive in the wild.
Sure.
And I just find that intriguing. I also find intriguing this car show, Rust Valley Restorers. I watch it regularly. I
hate to tell you, Nick, if we ever get nuked, plant life's fucked anyway. So, like, any of that stuff is not going to...
there could be other things.
Okay, yeah, I agree, but I was just like, that's a pretty much total loss.
If we ever have, like, you know, some sort of an apocalyptic level event
sure.
Where I still have to survive... I'd like to know a few things. It just makes my mindset feel better to learn and know things. Yeah. So it's a kind of learning base. And then another show I like to watch is Rust Valley Restorers.
Uh-huh.
A group of Canadians that are always restoring cars.
Okay.
And I kind of fantasize someday I'm like, maybe I'll restore a car too when I'm older. That'd be cool. Okay. And I'd like to know how to do it.
Yeah. Okay.
Anyway, goal setting. 80% of millionaires, I thought this would be higher, but only about 80% of them have daily goals.
Sure.
Poor people, 12% or less have daily goals.
Makes sense.
Yeah, makes sense. Waking time. This is interesting. Mm-hmm. 44% wake up 3 hours before the workday starts of rich people.
Yeah.
And with poor people, very few wake up early, and most tend to start at the last minute.
Yeah.
Well, that means they're running out the door. So which one are you?
Yeah, I'm guilty. Yeah. I mean, like, my business right now is very work in, not on,
mm-hmm.
which is okay. But, like, sometimes I'm running out the door. I mean, we also have a baby in the morning, so it's like taking care of her and then running out the door.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, multiple streams of income. 65% mm-hmm. have at least three streams of income, so 65% of millionaires. Poor people, most just rely on a single source of income. It doesn't actually give a percentage there, but it just says most.
Yeah.
And, so more than 50%.
With the streams of income, like, I just want to say real quick, like, if you're working a W-2 and having a hard time, you know, getting out of the rat race or whatever, consider owning a business, consider going into business ownership, or consider going into a side hustle. Very easy to do.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you find something you're passionate about and you can make money on the side, you should absolutely be doing that with your W-2 job.
Yeah. So when it comes to self-improvement and learning, so of the adults, you know, millionaire adults, 86% of them are continuing to learn, mm-hmm. read, and attend seminars.
Wow.
That's a big number. I thought that would be lower, but 86% of millionaires mm-hmm. are actually going to seminars and stuff wow. regularly, while only 5% of poor people tend to engage in self-improvement efforts in general. Risk-taking. Millionaires are more likely to take calculated risk and invest.
Mm-hmm.
Poor people tend to avoid risk. So they're not actually giving a stat there, which is disappointing.
Right.
I wanted stats.
And calculating risks is the main thing you should be focusing on, that one. Like, they don't take unnecessary risks on unnecessary business or investing in ventures. They know that, like, okay, doing these actions, I've seen this before, I've done this before, I know how this works. Everything's a risk, of course. It's a risk to stay poor. It's a risk to make more money. But you just have to be calculated in what an actual risk is.
Yeah. So millionaires, when it comes to savings and investing, millionaires save 20% of their income. So if you want something to, like, you know, if you want to mimic a millionaire,
mm-hmm.
Take 20% of whatever income you have and save it to invest in stocks or real estate or some other investments. That's what they do. Poor people, again, it doesn't really give a stat here. It just says save very little or none.
Sure.
So that maybe it was so low that it wasn't even worth giving a number.
So with, like, savings.
So, but that is true. Like, I think most Americans have less than $400 in their checking account.
Yeah. I think Ed Milet said, like, you know, almost 80% of Americans don't have $5,000 in their bank account. That's a staggering number.
I thought it was 400.
Well, that may be okay. A different one, but okay. I thought he said $5,000.
Yeah, I know that most people, more than half mm-hmm. of Americans, don't even have $400.
Yeah. Well, 80% don't have $5,000. So that's,
yeah.
But yeah. So speaking on that, like this is something that this kind of goes back into risks a little bit, right? So saving and investing. So what's really weird is the switch of the mindset, especially like in the stock market or real estate. You with investors, you know, you often hear people saying, like, If the market's down and people are scared, that's a really good time to buy.
Yep.
Right. Mm-hmm. And like, I've been really trying to take that to heart, especially with my stocks and real estate. Like, things are down. Like, it's time for me to pull the trigger. Fear and uncertainty makes it hard for people to make calculated decisions. And that's when investors come in and get things at, you know, a quarter of the price.
Yeah.
So
when it comes to long-term thinking, this isn't surprising, but, millionaires tend to focus on long-term goals and delayed gratification. And poor people often focus on immediate needs and short-term gains. And maybe, you know, what I've noticed, like shopping at Walmart versus Costco.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You tend to see a lot more beat up cars in Walmart than you do at Costco. Costco, sure. You tend to see a lot more nicer cars. And I think the difference is Costco, it's like you're buying in bulk.
Right.
You're long-term thinking, you know, I'm going to need these products, right. So I might as well get a bunch of them, store them in the house.
Yeah.
Places like gas stations and Walmart are heavily, you know, infested with poor people.
Sure.
because it just feeds an immediate need. It's a quick fix,
yep.
You know, especially. So just, like, look at the differences in parking lots and the cars that you see. It's a small, weird example, but I've noticed that. Have you noticed anything like that?
I haven't noticed. I don't shop at Costco, so that's that one's not on me. But I hear you. Like, it makes sense, right? You buy in bulk for the things you need.
Buy in bulk, and you get a better discount when you buy in bulk. It's just you're actually saving money when you look at the same or similar products at Walmart.
We just have to buy more. Costco orders, and we have them shipped to our house, so I don't actually go to Costco.
Okay, so you're part of the Costco crew.
I am part of the Costco crew, but I'm not like, I don't have to go there and have to deal with all the people.
Yeah. Mentorship, 93% of millionaires attribute their success to mentorship or guidance.
Mm-hmm.
93%.
I believe it.
So do you have a mentor? That's I'm asking you guys out there, like, do you have a mentor?
Yeah.
If you do, maybe you're on the right track.
Yeah.
If you don't, maybe that's somewhere to start.
Yeah.
Because poor people rarely seek or have any access to mentors.
Sure.
Can you give a mentor a reason to mentor you?
Great.
Like, what can you do for them to make it worth it?
Yeah.
So
with the analogy of this, I love to go into sports, honestly. Like, I think of, like, you know, Tom Brady's the best quarterback ever to play football, from my understanding. We don't really watch the sport, but, like, even Tom Brady had coaches and personal trainers, right? He had Bill Belichick, and he had personal trainers to help him stay in tip top shape. Because if he didn't have those, I'm sure he would probably fall into some bad habits, and he knows that, right?
Yeah.
You get these people to help you, keep you accountable if you can't do it.
Yeah, true.
Like Kobe Bryant, like, one of the best basketball players ever, you know, he had the best work ethic. You could see.
True.
Go look at his videos, and he talks about how he works out 4 times a day. He still had a shooting coach. Like, he still had somebody coming in there making sure he was, you know, elbow in, doing all this, and making sure it became part of the process.
Uh-huh.
So.
Nice.
Yeah.
Here's an interesting one. Volunteer work. 72% volunteer 5 hours per month or more of their time.
Okay.
Poor people rarely or never engage in any kind of volunteer work. So I actually saw this in action yesterday.
Yeah.
I was going to show a house in Hayden, and there were some people in the driveway just kind of pulling some stuff out of the house, or like setting up for an estate sale. This property was vacant, but they were setting up for an estate sale, and I recognized the lady. I'm like, oh crap, she used to be a neighbor, and I know that they're wealthy.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Connie? And she's like, no, Nick. She's like, oh my God, you've grown.
Yeah.
And I'm like, is this your house? And she's like, no, I'm volunteering for this. I volunteer for this group, and we're just setting up for the estate sale.
Oh.
I'm like, oh, that makes sense.
Cool.
She's just, so, I mean, and this, so this lady, she's volunteering her time, and she's wealthy.
Yeah.
So it's maybe a good habit to get into, maybe something I should do more of.
Yeah, I think that's really great. Honestly, like, there's part of me is always like, I'm working so hard so I can give more of my time later. Mm-hmm. You know, like I do volunteer quite a bit, but I enjoy doing it. It makes me feel good to give back, and like, it gives me that dopamine hit. Like, I am doing something good for the community here. So
yeah. So, the next couple of stats, they weren't really stats, but things we've already talked about again and again. So the last two are on health prioritization and blame and accountability. But the last thing, you know, we talked about health quite a bit. Millionaires, they tend to take personal responsibilities for failures and setbacks.
Mm-hmm.
Poor people, they tend to blame external circumstances for their situation.
Yep.
And man, if you don't take anything out of today other than that, I think that's one of the big ones.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
I mean, just the rich people, they take responsibility for their failures and setbacks, and they learn from them, and they move on.
Right.
Poor people, they blame, and nothing happens, you know. So, which one are you? Which one do you want to be? Start, because anybody anybody at any point can decide to take responsibility for their situation.
Mm-hmm.
And the moment you can make that mindset shift,
mm-hmm.
I think is the moment your life will change.
Yeah.
But you got to make it a habit.
Yep. Extreme ownership, right?
Yep. And sometimes you can follow that habit. I mean, I did it a couple of years ago when mm-hmm. My world was collapsing, and I wanted to blame others.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wanted to blame partners. I wanted to blame interest rates. I wanted to blame COVID. I wanted to blame the contractors. I wanted to blame everything
yep.
for my situation. But the reality was I got myself in that situation, and
yep.
I was the last person I blamed.
Mm-hmm.
So once I started blaming myself, I was able to finally take a shower,
mm-hmm.
get back in the game. And it took finally blaming myself and taking that accountability that I put myself in that situation. Now I need to fix it
yeah.
for me to move forward. And that's when my direction changed, and I was able to finally get past those setbacks.
I believe it. Yeah. Because honestly, you were basically sitting in a cesspool of your own failures trying
uh-huh.
to blame other people, but you have to get out of that damn pool.
Yeah. It didn't work. Like blaming people did nothing.
Mm-hmm.
It just made the situation worse.
Right.
It actually did make it worse.
I fully believe it, honestly, because you sit and you fester on these thoughts and these
yep.
feelings, you know, and thoughts become
and problems
things.
Stack up.
Right. And you start feeling it. And like, once you start, whew, you really got to, what we call them, it's automatic negative thoughts, ants. You fucking got to stomp that so quick.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, it will fester and it will like take an infect, right? So like the negativity in your life, you have to have almost a shield up, like, nope. And again, what we're talking about with accountability, like just take responsibility for your actions. And
yeah.
it's actually a weight off your shoulders. Responsibility for your actions and let go of your ego.
Yep. So just remember out there that these are habits.
Mm-hmm.
They aren't things. Once you do them, they don't stay in place forever. You got to work on them.
Yeah.
You got to be consistent about it. And I'm not perfect with any of these things
yeah.
either. I got to work on them every day.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully you guys learned something. Thanks for being around.
Yeah.
And if you like this episode, give it a little, give it nothing. Don't do anything. Just move on to the next video.
I like it. So, hey, if you've enjoyed what we've done here, don't say anything. We're
going to
take
anything.
All of the non-comments, non-likes as you loving the show.
That's me taking responsibility and just loving the results of me asking you guys not to do anything.
But for real, honestly, if you like the show,
no.
5-star reviews, comments, reviews are super great. Very grateful for all of you, and we will see you next week on the Investor Shed podcast.
Thanks, guys. Bye. Oh, not leave. There.
Pee-pee time.
We're still recording.
Thank you so much for checking out the Investor Shed podcast. If you enjoyed your time, make sure to leave a 5-star rating and review on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. Follow along on YouTube, TikTok, and Instagram at The Investor Shed for shorts and promos about each episode. Do you want to be a guest or know someone who has great real estate investing advice and stories? Reach out to us at theinvestorshed@gmail.com.